generation this nation has ever known. These men answered the call in a time of need, leaving their fields where they worked, leaving school for a chance of a higher education, leaving their families and friends for a chance to be part of those striving to preserve American freedom. Some of these men were not men at all. They had their mothers or fathers offer their birth certificates so that they could answer that call of duty at tender ages of 14, 15, 16. Young men of all races, many of whom had not even started to shave, heeded the call to serve their country, running away from home, fibbing about their ages, and devising all sorts of schemes to enlist in the military. These young men were determined to fight for their country, and would do whatever they could to put on a uniform. Many would never return home. Many young men, caught up in the patriotic ways sweeping the nation, volunteered for service in the Navy in spite of their age and complete lack of experience with anything to do with the sea. In fact, the majority of crew members on board destroyer escorts in World War II were teenagers or just barely out of their teens, most of whose experience on the water, if any, consisted of little more than fishing in a rowboat or paddling in a canoe. They answered the call, not for the idea that they may become heroes, but for the simple purpose of doing what was right, for doing what was needed in our nation's greatest time of need. On December 7th, 1941, our nation was attacked on our home field. As shock, horror, and anger spread throughout the land, the sense of national pride became a battle cry. No one beats us, especially here at home. These men answered that call of duty with one thought in mind, victory. Today we honor those who paid the price that gave you and I the privilege to be here today. What did they give it for? What have we done with their sacrifice? Today, we owe it to them to remember. Earlier this year, we commemorated Memorial Day, in which we paid tribute to all those who paid the price defending our nation's freedom. Several months ago, we commemorated D-Day, a day in which thousands of men gave their lives storming the beaches of Normandy. Today, we commemorate the men who gave their lives on a trim but deadly destroyer escort. On ships that were about 300 feet long and 35 feet wide, when they were attacked by a torpedo, a kamikaze pilot, or enemy fire, there was nowhere to run, nowhere to hide. On April 11, 1944, near midnight, a red flare, the color of grinding cast iron, suddenly appeared and dropped dead ahead of the USS Holder, followed by four bright yellow flares off the three-month-old vessel's starboard side. As they slowly descended, as if attached to parachutes, the sound of airplane engines pierced the darkness and the alarms were sounded. The Holder fired into the darkness and smoke machines were activated to help hide the ship. But by then it was too late. The Holder was a sitting duck for the Germans, a perfect silhouette in the bright moonlight as the flares helped to pinpoint the vessel for the German bombers. Suddenly, 35 German bombers and torpedo planes struck in a coordinated attack as they dived down, skimmed the water, and launched a torpedo which ripped right through the Holder amidships on the port side below the waterline. The Holder went dark. All power and communications were knocked out from the vessel, and the vessel began to list to the starboard. Fires erupted, and flames reached into the night as the ship, which now lay motionless, began to take on water. Brave young sailors remained at their battle stations as their ship, engulfed in flames, pounded the night sky with gunfire to keep the bombers from returning or harming any other ships in the convoy. It's still only one of the stories of the horrors and the heroic action taken by young men who only months before were sitting with their families at the dinner table. Other stories include harrowing accounts of sailors attempting to save their shipmates from fatal and near-fatal injuries. Stories of seeing their fellow shipmates who suffered burns that seared the skin off of their faces. Stories of abandoning ship and clinging to life rafts in freezing water while sharks circled and picked them off while waiting for rescue. These are the stories of ultimate sacrifice. Young men boarded destroyer escorts to combat the Germans and the Japanese subs. What they did not know is that they would make it home to once again unite with their families. In their time of war, doing their duty, they're either going to win or they're going to lose. They're either going to assure that the Stars and Stripes were flying over Washington, D.C. over 70 years later, or that their children and their grandchildren would be goose-stepping. It is indeed a battle of good versus evil. Don't you ever let history try to rewrite itself. Remember that Nazi Germany and Imperial Japan were evil empires that had to be defeated. It was a battle of light versus darkness. During World War II, over 1,300 DD sailors bled and they died, and they gave up their dreams at the young age of 17, 18, 19, and beyond, so that you and I could be free today. They gave what Abraham Lincoln penned as the last full measure of devotion, and they watered the tree of liberty as our founding fathers had said was required of every generation. And they did it without asking for anything in return. Because they believe in what we take for granted, freedom. We no longer consider sacrifice to be an honorable deed. We consider sacrifice to be a dirty word. Speak about sacrifice in your FDN auditorium. Write about adding sacrifice and you won't sell a book. We are in a world of moral relativism. Don't tell me what's right. Don't tell me what's wrong. Don't have an opinion that's contrary to mine. Don't stand up for your convictions. And whatever you do, don't remind me of the facts because the truth gets in the way of how I feel. We live in a world where feelings have replaced facts. But the fact remains, you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. 7 decades ago, a generation paid a price for you and I to be in this place today. 7 decades ago, what they did made a difference in our ability to be free. And we owe it to them to learn so we can see freedom preserved for the next generation. When World War II began, our military levels were low. We hear references that our military today is at pre-World War II levels. Literally, in terms of what we needed for winning the war, we had nothing. So how did we overcome it? First, America then knew now how to call upon the Lord. America then understood the power of prayer. America won because they did not debate about what it meant to say in God we trust. They knew who God was, and they knew what it meant to trust Him. When President Roosevelt heard with Dwight Eisenhower what the cost of the D&A invasion was going to be, when he knew that tens of thousands of green cars with white stars were going to pull up in front of the homes of American mothers and wives and tell them that their husbands and their sons and their brothers were not ever coming home again. 3 days before the invasion, Roosevelt retired to a retreat where he could begin to prepare his thoughts for what he was going to say to the nation the day after the battle. He knew that he had to address a hurting heart of a broken country, and he didn't know what to say. History records that he did not have much contact with the outside world in those 3 days. But after that period of time, on June the 7th, when the president addressed the nation over the radio, he began his address not by saying, "My fellow Americans." He began his address not by speaking about military success. When the radios all over the country, from Maine to California, came on, the President of the United States began this way. He said, "Almighty God," and for 7 minutes he prayed. Guinness Book of Records actually records it as the largest prayer meeting in global history. And it was not led by a deacon or by a pastor, but by a president. Why? Because 7 decades ago, we understood what it meant to be one nation under God. As newspaper reports were being sent in from all over the country, they showed factory workers in Chicago getting off their machines and kneeling on the factory floor to pray. They showed farmers out in the fields of California kneeling beside their tractors in order to pray. They showed judges in their black robes kneeling beside their benches wanting to pray. Right? Because he knew if we did not have God's help, we would fail. 7 decades later, we still need God's help. We live in a nation who has forgotten its foundation. We live in a nation who has forgotten the price of, that was paid for freedom. We live in a nation that wants to ignore what it took to get here and believe that we can endure it for the future in our ignorance. It's not possible. Prayer worked on D-Day and at other times during World War II. Prayer will work today. Not only was that generation committed that to prayer, that generation was committed to total victory. Let us learn from that generation. Let us learn that there is no fight worth fighting unless you are willing to have total victory. Let us learn that there is no substitute for victory. We owe a major apology to every man and every woman who has ever put on a uniform when we sent to battle without having victory as their objective. The men who served on the DEs and those that fought on other ships on the ground and in the air all knew that persistence would overcome their adversities, their adversaries. They knew that as long as they still fought, we would win. They were committed to victory. Even with the odds against them, they never gave up. Surrender was not in their vocabularies. They left their homes in the comfort of a warm bed and a delicious meal for an uncomfortable wrap, scratchy blankets, and food that they used to feed the hogs on the farms. They committed themselves to this way of life because our nation depended on them. America was not alone. We had the allies of the British and other countries in our efforts to defeat a common enemy. Winston Churchill knew that if America did not help them, they would certainly lose. Nations became unified, and with that unity, we become a powerful voice that Germany and Japan had no chance of defeating. There's something we can learn. Prayer still works. Persistence pays off. Commitment to victory overcomes the enemy. And unity brings power. If you're able, would you please stand and join me in prayer? With every head bowed, I want us to pray for our nation. I want us to understand what it means to call upon the Lord, to humble ourselves and pray, to ask Him to heal our land. Heavenly Father, today we stand before you, where we have called upon your name. We know that when these countless numbers of people called upon you during our times of strife, when our sailors prayed for your mercy as they watched their brethren die beside them, you comforted them and held them in your arms. We have called upon you for provision, for healing, for the strength to carry on, and you never failed. So today we call upon you for the sake of our country. We see the direction that it is headed, and we ask that you, God, help us turn it around. Unrighteousness does not ever speak for the righteous. We ask that you continue to remind us that the sacrifice of those brave men years ago was not in vain. We ask that you help us to keep their memories alive and not let our children, our grandchildren, and their children ever forget that supreme sacrifice that they made for the freedom we so easily take for granted. We thank you, Lord, for this freedom. We thank you, Lord, for giving us a generation that was indeed great, a generation that should continue to be made a role model for generations to come. We pray, dear God, that we never forget. We are a nation divided and we need your help. Help our leaders to make the right decisions in these troubled times, to not be ashamed of your name by professing their faith in you. We need your help, Lord. We need your blessing. While the storm clouds gather, I will cross the sea. Let us all be grateful for the land. God.